Hey, everybody, and welcome back to A Better Computer. My name is Matt, and today we're going to try to answer the question of, does Chrome use so much more battery than Safari? This is a thing I see all the time, is people saying that Chrome devastates your Mac's battery and Safari just sips it. It's very nice on your battery. And what frustrates me is that this is often presented with no data to back it up, and the data that we do have either comes from Apple or Google, which I don't care what their marketing teams say. And there's other tests people have run online, but I find them lacking in a lot of ways. Either they ran very short tests that don't give them a lot of data, or they ran one head-to-head comparison and they think that's going to be the answer every single time. Or even worse, they tested at different battery levels, which is not a good idea because macOS displays battery life non-linearly. So it drops low, it drops slower when your battery is near 100% than when it's near 10%. So if you're testing at different battery levels, you're not going to get the same results. So I wanted to do some testing. I thought this would be nice and quick, nice and easy thing to do. It turned out to be very complicated. I did 36 hours of testing when I posted a blog post with some initial results. I thought that was it. And then more and more things came up, and I've done like another 36 hours since then. So yeah, we're going to go through that initial finding to show you kind of what I discovered, how I did my testing and everything. And then in the second half of the video, we're going to go over the test itself. I'm going to walk you through how I did it, how I made it, how I executed it. And all of this is going to be available on GitHub for you. This was the other thing that was important to me. I wanted this testing to be available to you so you could see the data and you could run the test yourself and see what you got. All of this is available. If you use a Mac and Keyboard Maestro, you can do this yourself quite easily. The test is browser agnostic. So I tested in Chrome and Safari, but you can test it in whatever you want. It'll work in Firefox. It'll work in Arc. It'll work in Brave. It'll work in Vivaldi. It'll work in Edge. It'll work in whatever you want. It'll all work because it's all using the same keyboard shortcuts. So let's get into the blog post where I kind of walk through those initial results, and then we'll get into the test itself and you can see how much you want to trust these results. Okay, so let's take a look at the initial 36-hour test that I ran. I'm going to tell you what I did and the results of that first test. So we've already kind of talked about the preamble, what I did. Here's the test I ran. I ran it on a 14-inch MacBook Pro, an M2 Pro version with 16 gigs of RAM. I've had this computer 2 years, and it was actually recently restored to factory settings for Sequoia beta reasons. But anyway, it's a relatively fresh install of macOS with not a ton of things running, and it was using the stable versions of Chrome and Safari at the time. And yeah, basically what I did was I used Keyboard Maestro to create a macro that was 20 minutes long. So it would watch YouTube for 10 minutes, it would scroll social media for 4 minutes, and then for 2 minutes, it would browse 9to5 Mac. For 2 minutes, it would read an article on the New Yorker, and for 2 minutes, it would write in a Google Doc. I did close the YouTube window after it was done, so I didn't have just like a bunch of videos playing at the end, but the other 4 tabs stayed open. So every run of this 20-minute loop, I would have 4 new tabs open. What I ended up doing was running this test 9 times. So yeah, that would be what, 36 tabs open in the end. But this was basically a 3-hour browsing session, and then I could see how much battery was drained over the course of those 3 hours. Important note, I ran it in Safari, then Chrome, then Safari, then Chrome. Then I would recharge the battery to 100%, and I would do Chrome, then Safari, then Chrome, then Safari. So I alternated the order of the test because of that non-linear scale of battery display that macOS has. So I didn't want to test Safari at 100% every time and see tiny drops because it was actually just displaying the amount of energy usage differently up there. Display brightness was at 30%, a little low, but again, trying to just have the browsers be the thing that we're looking at here. And yeah, that's pretty much it. Kind of walked through all that. Minimal apps running in the background. And yeah, these numbers are pretty high, so you're probably going to see less battery life in real-world usage, and that's because you're probably listening to music, you probably have Slack or Discord open, you're probably doing other things on your computer besides just browsing. This is just browsing at a low brightness. And a quick note on variability. Do not trust anyone who does one single test and calls that a result. There's too much variability and they're too close to really call. So in the very first test I ran, Safari used 10% less battery usage than Chrome. In the second test, Chrome used 14% less than Safari. If I just did the Safari one once, or the test once, I would have said Safari was 10% better. In the following 5 runs, the following 5 direct comparisons, Chrome was better. So, you know, spoiling the result, I guess, but do not trust just one test. You have to run your test multiple times to get something that's actually more generally accurate, I think. I mentioned the variability and how macOS reports battery life, and here's what you're looking for. Here's the results. So over the 3-hour test, on average, again, it used less from the 100% when it started at 100%, more when it started at 40%, but on average, Safari would consume about 18% of your battery, Chrome would consume about 17%. And I shouldn't say your battery, my battery. In these tests on my computer, that's how much each of them used. This amounts to about 9% less battery drain on Chrome than Safari. Or if you look at the other way, Safari using 7% more, depending on which one you want to use as the numerator and denominator. And yeah, so this was the opposite of common knowledge, which is why I ended up doing so much testing, because I wanted to make sure I had it right before I shared anything. And these are just the results. I don't have as much detail here because I wasn't prepared. I wasn't expecting to do this much testing, so I didn't collect as much raw data along the way. But in these tests, again, the 17 and 16 numbers there, per hour, that amounts to about 0.5%. Over 8 hours, less than 4%. And if you try to go from 100 to zero at this rate, if it does keep that average, it would be about an extra hour that you would get from Chrome in this test. What's a good way to look at this? I thought an 8-hour workday was a good way to look at this. So after 8 hours at this rate, you'd likely see your Mac battery life showing 50% if you were using Safari and 54% if using Chrome. That's technically a difference, but it really isn't a big deal in my opinion. If you don't enjoy the browser you're using for those 8 hours, then who cares if you have 4% more? So I think in general, my takeaway is that you should use the browser that you prefer. If you prefer the UI, the privacy options, the compatibility options, the system integrations of Chrome or Safari more, use that one, because the battery life is probably not a huge deal. It's probably not making a big difference. There's a whole bunch of stuff here. Last thing I'll say on this test is I'm not even a Chrome user. I don't like Chrome particularly. I use Arc on the Mac. I'm actually testing Zen browser right now, but I use Arc on the Mac. If Arc went away, I'd probably go to Vivaldi. If Vivaldi went away as well, then I'd probably go to Safari. I prefer Safari to Chrome, but like, I don't have any horse in this race. I don't particularly want to use either of these browsers as my day-to-day browser. They're fine. I know people love them. I think that they're great browsers in general, but they're just not the ones for me. So that was the first test. Now let's get into what I actually did. All right, and to be clear, all of this is downloadable from GitHub. So everything I'm going to show you right now, you can download from GitHub. We have the macros that I ran, two versions of it, one that keeps all the tabs open and one that just loads everything in the same tab, if you think the results will be different that way. And then the test results are all here as CSVs. If you want to look at the CSVs, the raw data is here for my testing if you wanted. And then these sorts of files will be generated from the test, so you can kind of collect your own if you want. But what's the test? So we kind of went over the first one, but I modified it based on the feedback I got from the first test that I did. So basically, it's creating a variable so I can know what run number I'm on. At the start, it will use this Apple script. It runs this Apple script to document the time and the battery percentage to a CSV file called data.csv. Brilliant, I know. That sits in my downloads folder. If it isn't there, I think it will create it. It will create it. So excellent. So it generates the file for you. It'll just be in your downloads folder unless you modify this. And then the loop begins. This is the main event. So you can have this loop as many times or as few times as you want. You can see my most recent tests were 20 loops. This one was about 16 minutes, so a little shorter than the one we just talked about. But again, the mix of things we're doing is different. So it's going to display a notification that tells you the run number and the battery percentage, and then it's going to hit Command L and then load this YouTube video. It's going to watch that video for 5 minutes. Then it's going to, we're looking at the one tab version right now. Then it's going to go to the address bar again, load my Is Feeling Social Mastodon feed. I'm going to scroll that 50 times. Then I'm going to 9to5 Mac. We're going to scroll that 10 times. We're going to go to the New Yorker, scroll that 10 times. And there's a delay in all of these, so it kind of simulates actually being on the page and reading and then scrolling. You're not just like scrolling, scroll, 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 and then new tab. It's trying to be a little bit more realistic. Then we open a Google Doc that I created for myself. And I put this, I just typed some random things into it. I have a crazy looking Google Doc for this. I open Readwise Reader, which is a web app. I open Quick Reviews, which is my web app. And then I open Claude, which is another web app. And then we use that same Apple script basically to append a new line to that data.csv file with the new timestamp and battery percentage. And so, yeah, that's really it. And then at the end, there's a notification that says test finished at this time. So I can just know when the test finished, although I get that from the data CSV anyway. Now here's the data. I've kind of imported all of the CSVs that I have so far. I've done 6 tests with this new loop with the many tabs option, so where I leave all the tabs except the YouTube one open. And I've only done 2 runs with the all from one tab, where I did Safari and Chrome, 1 run each. So let's take a look at some of the results. Reading these aren't super exciting, although the one thing I'll call you two is comparing these 2 Safari runs. So the same number of loops, right? The same amount of time. So 2 hours and 47 minutes, 2 hours and 47 minutes down to the second. But how much battery was consumed? When I started at 100%, you'll actually notice it took 1 hour and 7 minutes for it to drop to 99%. It showed 100% for over 1 hour. And then the whole test run showed 13% of usage. When I started the test at 41% battery in the menu bar, that same test, just 16 minutes later, we're already down 2%. It took us an hour and 20, basically, to get that same drop over here. Over the whole test, again, the 2 hours and 47 minutes, 21%. So there's definitely some real variability in how quickly the battery shows itself draining based on where you start the test. So those are the Safari ones. Here's the Chrome ones. Again, I need to do more Chrome ones, but you can kind of see the same thing. When you start at 100, you get numerous instances where it's showing 100%, whereas it starts to drop quicker when you're at lower percentages. But let's take a look at this graph. This is my first visualization of it, basically showing how many percent. This is kind of, it's a weird, should probably reverse it if I can, but basically showing how much of a percentage has dropped over time. They're all starting at the same point. And you can kind of see these ones down here are clearly the ones that started at 100% because it does not drop for quite a while. And then they start to drop and it's a relatively linear drop. To be clear, the green lines are Chrome, the blue lines are Safari. And you can kind of see when we start at 100%, they hold steady and then they kind of start to use battery at the same rate. When they start lower, they are still losing battery at about the same rate. Safari's losing a little bit more there. We do get to this point with the multi-tab one. This is one I want to do more testing on, where at a certain point, and I don't know if this is because the RAM usage gets insane or because the just the percentages get lower, but Safari just starts to accelerate how quickly it consumes battery life. In my one really long Chrome test that I did in this testing method, it actually stayed pretty linear longer. So I'm curious what the difference was there. But yeah, these Safari ones really accelerated at the end. If we look at the one comparison, so take this with a grain of salt. I've only done this one once. The long run where we just do one tab, we don't have many tabs open. We just keep replacing what's in one tab. The degradation over, this is a 5.5 hour run, 25% from Chrome, 24% from Safari. And if we look at the metrics here, they're basically just straight together. There's no significant difference here. Again, I should run this more to get more data, but based on the many tests I've done, again, in the 36 hours we just looked at, plus these tests, they tend to be, if they start at the same battery percentage, they do tend to stay relatively close together in my findings. So I wouldn't expect tons of variance here, but who's 1% better here or there might change from run to run. So that's what I've got so far. I'm not perfect. I don't think this test is absolutely perfect, but I think it's better than most things I've seen. And again, I do think it's important that this is available for anyone to test and compare. This isn't technically a peer review or anything, but like, I think this is important to have it available. Other things not considered. I have a list here of things that are not considered that may want to be added by others. RAM usage. I did not test for RAM in this. A couple times randomly I did check. I added up all the processes related to Safari, related to Chrome. Chrome tended to use a tiny bit less RAM as well, which again is counter to the narrative. But I wasn't testing for that aggressively. Video calls. I was not testing any video calls with like Google Meet or anything like that. If you do those, I don't know how those impact browser to browser. Obviously, those are pretty heavy. Those tend to push the browser pretty hard. but I don't know which one's more effective there. I did not test other browsers. I mentioned that. So Firefox, if you want to know that, I don't have that data right now. With other apps running, so I mentioned in a real world use case, you might have Slack running, you might have just a bunch of other apps running on your computer. I didn't include those in this. So if the differences are more significant, the less resources overall these browsers are given, this doesn't capture that. And extensions. Again, I kept it pretty minimal with just a password manager. I did run one test with a ad blocker to see if that made a big difference. It didn't make any difference at all. The results were still kind of in the, what am I trying to say? They were all within the margin of errors I was seeing with other tests, so that didn't seem to be a result. And yeah, so those are things that are not accounted for here, and maybe we could improve in the future, but wanted to share this today to give you an idea for what the testing looked like, how you can do the testing yourself, and hopefully it was interesting. So thank you so much for watching. Bye-bye.